We are delighted to be here at BCTV again for our monthly Berks Opera Presents. Tonight we're going to talk about upcoming events, welcome back a wonderful singer, and talk about music and technology. So let's get right to it. Our next upcoming event is Thursday evening, March 23rd at 7 p.m. at Phoebe Berks Village in Wernersville. This is the next in our series of multimedia opera soiree entertainment extravaganzas, which we call Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan. Now, these are really the best entertainment value in the Reading area. We combine a wonderful live singer, great music, great singing, a little bit of education, a little history lesson and culture, wine, coffee, dessert, and good company. It's a fun way to get to know more about opera and to help your inner opera fan come to the surface. Now, these presentations are sponsored by the Reading Movies 11 and IMAX Theater, where you can see the live in high definition broadcasts from the stage of the Metropolitan Opera. Indeed, each of our Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan presentations gives you an introduction to one of the upcoming Metropolitan Opera live in HD broadcasts. And our presentation on March 23rd at Phoebe Berks is entitled Decisions, Decisions, or Why Him, Lord? Now, this will be an introduction to Mozart's first really great important opera called Idomeneo, the King of Crete, which the Metropolitan Opera will broadcast live in HD on Saturday afternoon, March 25th, starting at 12:55 with a wonderful cast. So, if you want to learn more about this wonderful and interesting opera, please come to Phoebe Berks Village this March 23rd at 7 p.m. And if you want to see the opera live in high definition, go down to the Reading Movies 11 and IMAX on Saturday, March 25th for the performance that starts at 12:55. Now, for our presentation at Phoebe Berks, admission is free for Phoebe Berks residents. For others, it's $20 for adults and seniors, $15 for students and young people under 30. Reservations are not required, but we'd be delighted if you contact us anyway and tell us you want to come. You can pay at the door by cash or credit card, or you can pay via PayPal at the Berks Opera Company website, which is berksopera.org. For more information, you can contact the website or contact Berks Opera at berksoperacompany@gmail.com or call 484-752-2462. Now, on our live presentations, Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan, we always have live artists. And on March 23rd, we're going to be presenting soprano Maggie Riker, who is here with me today in the studio, and we'll be speaking with her in just a few minutes. Maggie is a fantastic coloratura soprano. We will also have a pianist named Caleb Flick, who has played for many of our productions and many of our interviews and many of our opera presentations in the Unleashing Your Inner Opera series. So, last year we hosted Maggie on this show with a lot of questions about her background as a singer, and we are delighted to welcome her back. So, welcome, Maggie.
Thank you, David.
Thanks for coming back.
Thank
so,
you.
First we're going to talk about Maggie, and we're going to talk with Maggie, and we're going to talk about her a lot, and we're going to talk with her a lot. So, Maggie is a coloratura soprano. Just what the heck is a coloratura soprano, Maggie?
What is a coloratura soprano? Well, we all know what a soprano is, hopefully.
Hopefully. She's the
voice,
high ones.
The high female voice. The coloratura is the highest of the female voices. I like to say coloratura is the one, if you need something sung high and fast, that's what you need is a coloratura soprano. Now, within the coloratura classification, there are a lot of kind of sub-classifications of coloratura. There's a dramatic coloratura, which is the queen of the night. Very big, bold, dramatic voice.
Loud and fast.
Loud and fast, but also has a range of about B below middle C up to a high F above high C.
Okay.
And then there's the light lyric coloratura, which is generally the Gildas from Rigoletto, or Lucia is generally a light lyric coloratura or a lyric coloratura, although many dramatic coloraturas have also sung that role.
Mm-hmm.
A voice like Maria Callas could be heard by some as a lyric coloratura, but then as she got older, she kind of ventured into some more of the dramatic repertoire and sort of sung with a more full-bodied tone.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So that in a nutshell is.
Is there such a thing as a comic coloratura?
A comic coloratura? Well, there's Zerbinetta.
Yep, she's pretty funny.
She's very funny. Adele has her laughing song.
Yep.
So, I don't know if
we have Olympia in the Tales of Hoffman.
Olympia.
So we can think of three examples already.
Yeah, so maybe Lee came up with a new classification.
It is, the comic coloratura. She has to be able to sing, stand on her head, tell jokes, and do everything. So what are you going to be singing on March 23rd at Phoebe Berks?
Well, I think it will be a first for the Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan series.
Great.
That we will be performing, I will be performing an entire role for in 20 minutes.
Okay.
I will be singing the Queen of the Night.
Okay.
And since the Queen of the Night only has two big aria as well, and one trio, which I won't be singing because I can't sing a trio by myself, but I'll be presenting both Queen of the Night arias that night.
Super. Mm-hmm. Super. So what is this opera about, The Magic Flute? People have heard about it. Is it anything like The Lion King?
The Magic Flute like The Lion King? Well, I guess there's a battle for a throne, sort of.
There's animals in costumes.
Oh, there you go. There's Magic Flute. It's, you know, to some it's just a classic good versus evil, light versus darkness, sun versus moon. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of Masonic elements in it. Mm-hmm. Mozart himself being a Mason, and also the librettist, Schikaneder, was a Mason as mm-hmm. well. So there's a lot of that symbolism in the opera. But the
sort
story...
Is there some battle of the sexes stuff in there?
I guess you could see that, too.
Moms versus dads for control of their kids?
You could see that, too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of symbolism there, a lot of allegories you could paint with that story. But generally, the plot is the Queen of the Night is
she's the mom.
She's
right?
the mom. She has the daughter, Pamina. And Pamina is being held by Zarastro, who is the antithesis of the queen. He is the sun, the good side, the light.
He's the queen, dad, right?
He's the dad. And the queen gets Prince Tamino through summoned by the three ladies, which work for the queen, mm-hmm. Summons Tamino to go and rescue her daughter, who's been captured and is being held captive by this evil Zarastro. Short story is, Tamino goes to rescue her, finds out that he really believes in the ideals that Zarastro sort of espouses, and starts his initiation process to become one of Zarastro's on his side, so to mm-hmm. speak. The queen gets pretty peeved at this and summons her daughter and tells her daughter, here's a dagger, go and kill Zarastro. And if you don't, you're no longer my daughter and I will never talk to you again.
Wow, okay.
So that's the vengeance aria, the famous vengeance aria.
So the two arias, the second one is where she says, go kill your dad.
Yeah.
And the first aria, what is she doing in that one?
The first aria, she's persuading Tamino to go and rescue her daughter. The German is, O zittere nicht, mein lieber Sohn. My loving son, please go and rescue my daughter. Mm-hmm. She was taken from me in the night. And it's a very dramatic aria where she kind of play acts the whole scene of her being taken from her in the night. And she cried for help and no one came.
Oh. Yeah.
But you, Tamino, you have the courage to go and rescue my daughter and go and find her for me. Yeah.
Super. So what do these arias sound like?
So what do the arias sound like?
So people can have an anticipation. Or shall we let them be surprised when let's give them a hint, but let them be surprised.
The first arias opens with a very dramatic kind of legato lines where she's kind of weaving her tale, telling her sad story. There's a lot of kind of guttural noises and very passionate plea to mm-hmm. Tamino to go and rescue her daughter. And then the music changes and it becomes this allegro kind of passionate kind of mandate for him to go out. And it's filled with lots of coloratura and ends on a high F and little, you know, the kind of a glimmer of foreshadowing of the high Fs that come in the Vengeance aria.
Great. Okay.
Yeah.
So in the Vengeance aria, I think, was in the movie Amadeus, wasn't it?
It was.
When the mother-in-law is screaming at Mozart. Is that what he used it for?
I think so.
He uses the aria to sound like a woman nagging and screaming at her son.
It could sound like that.
Cool.
Yep.
So maybe that's why Mozart wrote that like it did. It's like, I think that in the movie Amadeus, that was really kind of an interesting interpretation of it.
And it's interesting because that aria, if you're a sort of a student of opera and you listen to the different renditions of that are, even kind of in the current time. You know, you have every voice type from Sumi Jo to Natalie Dessay, which is the light lyric coloratura, mm-hmm. very high, chirpy, almost French-sounding mm-hmm. coloratura. And then you have Adita Gruborova, and you have Diana Damrau now, who's a big, full-voice, dramatic coloratura who's mm-hmm. singing the role. Mm-hmm. So it really depends on what the conductor wants to convey with that character.
Mm-hmm.
If they want it to be kind of a supernatural, ethereal Queen of the Night, they'll choose a more light lyric coloratura. If they want it to be more of a
Princess of Darkness,
kind of Princess
thing.
Of Darkness kind of role, you know, then they'll generally opt for a more dramatic type of mm-hmm. voice to sing the role. So, and it's pretty thrilling when you have a big voice singing that role, mm-hmm. and those Fs pop out of that, and the voice is huge, and it fills the theater, the auditorium. It's pretty powerful stuff.
Right, and any bats that are flying around the theater will run from the will fly away, holding their ears from all the wonderful high notes.
The high notes, yes.
Cool.
Yes.
Well, we're gonna launch into a discussion now about music and its relation to some other things. And this is music not just in the context of opera, but music generally. And we're gonna be advocating here. And many of you are already convinced. But if any of you don't believe us now, I think hopefully you'll believe us when we're done. And we're gonna talk about how music is one of the most important things a person can participate in. You've all heard the music teachers say that music education is important. And when we're done, we're going to know, I think, why we say that a little better. Believe me, it's not just to keep music teachers from starving, although that's a worthy goal. Most music teachers I know are really bright people and very accomplished and can make a lot more money by doing something else. We know there is a connection between music and math and science. The ancient Greeks considered music one of the branches of science, along with math and geometry. Now, Maggie works in a very, very interesting technology company, which is run and owned by her family. So, Maggie, tell us a little about Cody Systems. What does Cody do?
Well, Cody Systems writes law enforcement software for RMS, or for police, so records management software, computer-aided dispatch software. We started back 36 years ago, 1979. We started writing software for police. We also, which is our kind of our calling card at the moment, is our Cobra.net data aggregation and data exchange platform, mm-hmm. which is truly changing the landscape for us. We were way ahead of our time, and the first cross, so what Cobra does, let me back up a second. What Cobra does is it allows municipalities to share RMS or records management crime data mm-hmm. across municipal boundaries.
Mm-hmm. So, and that's a big new thing.
This is a challenge, yes. This is a challenge because each police department within a county, let's say Berks County, for example, which has a Cobra.net system, and Berks County was the first, was kind of the spearhead project for this mm-hmm. software back in, late 1990s. It allows each of these police departments have their own records management system, which is written in a different database, which is generally is their software provider. It's a different provider. It's written in a different language. Mm-hmm. And what Cobra does is Cobra sits at the top and allows all of these different police departments to share their data in real time.
Sort of like the stage director in an opera.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, right. We'll bring this back to music very often. Very often we'll come back to music here. Yeah.
But so on a smaller scale, at the county level, it does this for Berks County, it does this for Bucks County, Chester County, Lehigh mm-hmm. County, Northampton County. All of these counties in Pennsylvania are currently using the Cobra.net platform to share data across municipal boundaries. Mm-hmm. So if in Berks County, for instance, if there's a crime that happens in one municipality before Cobra, an officer in another municipality on the other side of the county would never know mm-hmm. that this guy was a known offender, for
right.
instance.
Got it.
But with Cobra in place, they do.
Cool.
They have that information, and it's in real time.
Mm-hmm. So who founded Cody?
My parents founded Cody.
Cool.
So it is a family business.
Is it a state
business.
Secret to see how long ago it was they founded it?
No, I already said it, David.
Oh.
36 years ago, 1979.
Right.
Yep. It was actually on my birthday, so I just told you my age, too.
Great. Now, here's my first loaded question.
Okay.
Were the founders of Cody musicians?
Yes, they were.
Okay. Notice.
Yeah. So the founder, David Hefner, my dad, really began his career as a musician. Mm-hmm. He was, he sang at the Hilltones. He went to the Hill School right in Pottstown. He was in the Hilltones. He wrote musicals. He performed in musicals. He went to Drexel University for business and was writing musicals for his fraternity that he was a part of there.
So he was a trained musician.
Trained musician. And he taught himself guitar.
Okay.
He says he taught himself guitar to impress the ladies.
It must have worked.
It must have worked because he married my mother, who was a knockout, beautiful woman he met playing guitar, actually. I can't remember the name of the place they met. But
more benefits of music. You
there
meet
you go.
Girls.
So, but he actually was a fantastic 12-string guitar player. He played with the Kingston Trio. He was actually stationed. He was in the Army Intelligence Agency, which is the computer background.
Okay.
Ties in. He was stationed in, I believe it's Fort Hood in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. Horrible place to be stationed.
Terrible, right? Terrible.
But while he was there, he had a very good music career, very, very well known. Actually, legend has it that if you go to Hawaii, to the area where he lived, they still remember Dave Cody.
Well.
And he had the name Dave Cody. Quick story. Dave Cody was actually... The name Cody was actually given to my father from the great-grandson of the late Pony Express rider, Buffalo Bill Cody.
Wow.
He heard my father sing the national anthem. They had a rodeo in, I think it was the Centennial Rodeo, or the Bicentennial Rodeo, I guess it was, in 1976 in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. And my dad sang, I think it was at the Vet, could have been, was
could,
that?
Could be.
At 1976, that must have been. My father sang the national anthem. Buffalo Bill Cody's grandson, or was it his great-grandson? I think his great-grandson, heard my dad sing, made sure to talk to him about it. They became friends. They were out to dinner one night, and legend has it that over a drink and a dinner napkin, they wrote a contract saying that he could use the name Cody for his stage name as a singer.
Okay, cool.
And, yeah.
Yeah, so now let's, how many people work at Cody?
We're small business, so we're the under 50 small business.
Okay, so
in Pennsylvania.
How many hardcore techies do you have?
We're all hardcore techies.
Good.
Now, I mean that really. I mean, the way our business is, you really can't project manage, you can't train, you can't without being a hardcore techie. Now, of course, we have the development guys who are the ones under the hood really doing the nuts and bolts coding.
Sure.
But everyone knows, has to know enough technology to be considered a techie in our world. So.
Now, for my next loaded question.
Sure.
How many of your people, or what percentage would you guess, are musicians?
I asked her before,
so I know the answer.
I don't actually guess this. I will tell you that I will be close to half of the people who work at Cody, starting with our executive vice president, who's my brother, mm-hmm. who has a degree in music from Rice University. He's a brilliant, again, 12-string guitar mm-hmm. player.
He
plays
sings,
piano.
I think.
Self-taught, all self-taught. He sings, he did musicals, I mean, he studied musical theater.
Mm-hmm.
I'm the director of marketing for Cody. I went to Oberlin Conservatory, studied vocal performance. I obviously have a background
sure.
in music.
Sure.
Several of our developers and software folks. I actually was talking to a couple of the guys, and it's interesting to see the types of music they're involved in.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of them are actually involved in electronic music, which mm-hmm. is very cool because they're kind of tying in the tech side and the music side come together
right.
to create this kind of
and
cool.
And at least
fusion.
One of your people has sung with Berks Opera,
right.
Chris
right.
Sterner.
Chris Sterner.
Who is a wonderful actor and a fine
wonderful
singer.
Wonderful actor, fine singer.
He's a software designer? Is he
yeah,
a,
he's data services.
Data services,
yep, so
yeah.
he's in mapping data. He's one of the guys who makes sure that this agency's data is part of a COBRA. system can become part of a choral. He writes that software that links the two together.
Sure.
One of the guys told me that he was involved in competitive choir in high school.
Mm-hmm.
It was in a handbell choir in high school, which I thought was very cool, and they were competitive handbell choir.
And that's very, very technical and intense.
Oh, yeah. And there have been many times when the tech guys, you know, when you're dealing with a technical support issues left and right, it can be a very heady, very, very stressful experience when you have a customer, and our customers are public safety. So when their system is having an issue, it's mission critical.
Right.
This is not something where we can take a support ticket and get it done in the next few days or 48 hours.
Right.
Those problems have to be fixed, and they have to be fixed now.
Right.
So there's a lot of stress.
Like putting on an opera.
Yeah, there you go. He does it again, pulls it back to music.
Everything comes back to music. That's what we're going to tell you tonight if you haven't figured it out already.
Well, what I was going to say is that once one of those kind of stressful tech support issues is resolved, there's a number of times when the guys, there's so many are musically inclined in the tech area that you'll hear four-part harmony coming from the tech support room.
Sure, great.
Yeah, so very, very, I really do see a lot of, we were talking about the connection between being a musician and being a techie, and, you know, even if you just think about just the artistry to design code, mm-hmm. and to take numbers and dashes and letters and put them into a sequence and a pattern that then has some kind of graphic and visual representation that means something to someone else.
And it actually accomplishes something.
Accomplishes something.
Like music. It looks, you can see it on the page, and it's a code, it's a language,
right.
And then you perform it, if you will, like software code is performed, mm-hmm. and a fantastic result happens.
Right.
Or a train wreck. Hopefully none of the latter.
Yeah, good.
Well, I'm going to tell you a few more examples about people in highly technical and sophisticated careers. And these are the careers that are going to keep America competitive in today and tomorrow. They're musicians. They studied, they practiced, they performed, and in many cases, they still do. I heard a man say that he was at a convention of New York financiers and bankers. What were they doing for fun? They were playing jazz on their piano. I was at a wedding a couple years ago, and one of the groom's buddies got up to play sax with this fantastic local band named Reggie Brown.
Mm-hmm.
He's a local band leader, absolutely fantastic. Always hire Reggie Brown and his band for your weddings. And he played, he was absolutely smoking hot. What is his field? Finance. He's a Wall Street trader. Music and math. I had two friends in our church choir years ago who were both brilliant scientists with Bell Labs, AT&T, inventors. Both were conservatory trained, professional level musicians. Music and science. I know a young woman personally who played piano and sang in the Berks Youth Chorus all through high school, then sang in her university chorus and was music director of her a cappella group in college. She majored in math and computer science. She sang in fantastic choirs in London, England while she was working over there. She's now a senior vice president with Goldman Sachs and handles multi-billion dollar investment portfolios, music and math. I know another young man that sang in the Berks Youth Chorus and sang in his college choir in an a cappella group. He's finishing his doctorate in computational linguistics, which is a very sophisticated field that explores the relationship between language and computers. It is directly connected with artificial intelligence, including homeland security applications. This coming year, he will be a postdoctorate scholar at University of Pennsylvania's Wharton School, Music and Computers. I saw an interview with the head of a major computer company. He said he always tries to hire computer programmers who are musicians. He says their approach to organization and abstract reasoning is superior. Research a number of years ago showed that over 90% of the software engineers in Silicon Valley were musicians, directly participating in music. And one of my last anecdotes is about 40 years ago, I sang in the chorus at the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. In the same opera we'll be talking about at Phoebe Berks. The lead tenor had sung in major opera companies with Beverly Sills and other stars and was at the top of a successful career. But one day in about 1979, he bought a personal computer. It must have been a pretty primitive gadget back then. And taught himself to write software. He soon became one of America's early entrepreneurs in software retailing, where he made a very successful career for many years. Many years. He did get back into music for a while, but then stayed in technology. Right here in our local community, Dr. Neil Hoffman is a brilliant clarinetist and has also been the head of pathology at Reading Hospital. Dr. George Kirshner is another brilliant doctor, plays piano superbly. Bob Kreitz is a pianist and an attorney. So these tremendous outcomes don't just come from passive enjoyment of music through electronic media or superficial learning of music by rote from a recording and singing a few pop tunes from a microphone, you know, in search of instant child stardom. This is what comes from the serious devotion to the study and performance of music, learning to read and understand music well, the relationship between those that it's like secret code on a page if you don't know what it is, but it's like learning another language. It's the dedication of showing up to rehearse in the chorus or practice your instrument for many hours a week, trying to understand what Mozart or Verdi or Bach or Beethoven or Duke Ellington were trying to say when they wrote their music. So that's the kind of music education and the kind of education that will send kids off to brighter futures in the 21st century. So, enough of my hard sell, more events. March 23rd at 7 p.m. at Phoebe Berks, Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan. Our next BCTV program airs April 12th. On April 27th, we will have Opera Night at Judy's on Cherry from 6:30 to 8:30. Check the dates. Contact Judy's and contact Berks Opera to find out exactly what the further details are. May 12th will come our final Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan event of the season. We'll be talking about Richard Strauss's opera Der Rosenkavalier. Berks Opera Company's summer production is in August, La Cenerentola, which is Rossini's version of the Cinderella legend. Tickets go on sale June 1st at the Miller Center for the Arts at RAC, or you will be able to buy them online from Miller Center. So that's all tonight. Just a reminder, Berks Opera Presents on BCTV is a monthly program held the second Wednesday of each month at 7:30 p.m. You can also watch online by going to click on the link that says On Demand at the bctv.org website. And if you'd like to volunteer for Berks Opera, there are many opportunities. Just contact Berks Opera at berksoperacompany@gmail.com. We will not rest until we see you at the opera. Thanks, and thank you, Maggie.
Absolutely. Thank you.
You're welcome.
This program is supported by Berks Opera Company, which presents Unleashing Your Inner Opera Fan in partnership with Reading Movies 11 and IMAX. Berks Opera Company offers unique and entertaining events in some of Berks County's most elegant homes. For tickets, contact Berks Opera Company at P.O. Box 251, Reading, PA 19603, email berksoperacompany@gmail.com, or call 484-752-2462. Thank you.